Michael Burry warns that we may be on the path for hyperinflation, and he says that gold and Bitcoin might not protect you from the collapse of currencies, as governments will try to squash them to protect their national currencies. In today's video, I will go over what did Michael Burry said, and also if we are on the same path for hyperinflation as happened in Weimar Germany. So on that timeline, where are we right now? Also, I will go over some other inflation hedges, inflation protection investments that I'm doing alongside gold for that exact reason. Government may manipulate the price of gold temporarily. I don't believe that they can suppress it forever, but until the price of gold, break from their grasp, I also want to have some other inflationary protected investment that will do well. So let's dive right in. Okay, so this is from Market Insiders. Big short investor Michael Burry turns to Warren Buffett to underscore the dangers of inflation. And then he goes to a letter that Buffett wrote to his investors in the 1980s, because as you may know, in the 1980s we had very high inflation, so Buffett addressed that problem back then. And in the letter, Buffett explained that high rates of inflation act as a tax on capital, discouraging companies from investing by reducing their real returns. Inflation can also result in investors earning negative returns, Buffett said, because it serves as an implicit tax on their purchasing power on top of the explicit taxes they pay on dividends and investment gains. Burry dredged up the letter to emphasize that if inflation ramps up, corporate profits today will be far more valuable than corporate profits in the future. And then he says, if high inflation, each dollar of earning today becomes important. He continued, earning 10 and 20 years from now, the corollary goes, may be worth substantially less tomorrow than today. And then he says that prepare for inflation as the US economy reopens and receive fresh round of stimulus. And this is exactly where we are right now. The economy reopened from the shutdowns. People are going back to work, employment going back up. And at the same time, we are having stimulus. Biden is talking about, infrastructure plans. And I think there will be another stimulus package down the line at some point, or it may be part of the infrastructure, big plan. In another article from Market Insiders, they write that the big short investor Michael Burry says, prepare for inflation, and warns Bitcoin and gold might be at risk. He says that governments may squash Bitcoin and gold to protect their currency, which, kind of makes sense that they will try to destroy competing currencies. Not that I think that Bitcoin is a competing currency, but if they may look at it, they may try to destroy it. Prepare for inflation, the investor said in a now deleted tweet on Thursday night. Reopening and stimulus on the way. Pre-COVID, it took $3 of debt to create $1 of GDP, of GDP growth. And it is now worse. In an inflationary crisis, the government will move to squash competitors in the currency arena, BTC and gold. Burry highlighted passages from the book about the recurrence of inflation throughout history, how it's usually preceded by an economic boom and a spike in overnight fortunes, and how it leads to a soaring crime, surging living cost, and poverty. Now, does that sound to you like today? Because in today, a lot of people that are invested in growth stocks made huge fortunes. Look at Tesla, people that bought GameStop. In general, anyone that, invested in growth companies in 2020 made a lot of money, a lot more than investing, even in gold and even in than a lot of you know, the big gold miners, and obviously a lot more people participated in the growth stocks than, you know, gold, in the gold sector. And at the same time, what do we see? We have protests. We have people that are living on social security. We have people that are dependent on government stimulus, or, you know, they are just existing because the government made it possible for them not to pay their rent. So, and we have this like fake economic boom. We see that GDP numbers this year are very high, but at the same time, we are seeing that inflation is starting to be very high. So it sounds really similar to what Burry is describing. He says that Germany started by not paying adequately for its war. And then he says that we had a similar situation with the, you know, Cervasic sickness, or this, you know, this sickness crisis. To pay for that war, the people didn't have to sacrifice anything. They didn't have to pay, they didn't pay for it by taxes, but they covered its deficit with war loans, treasuries, which is the treasuries that we sell today. And they issue a new paper, Reichmarks, and he says that it's the same, like, you know, how we are printing the dollar. And then he says, doomed to repeat. Now, let me tell you a story from Israel. In Israel, in the Yom Kippur War, the government spent a lot of money. A lot of money, you know, war is expensive. Ammunition, destroyed tanks, fuel for, you know, for all the machinery, you know, bombs, also the damage that went into the economy. The government was really, you know, the country was really hurt financially. But when the war ended, the government didn't pay for the war by raising taxes. They printed and printed and printed money and made it seem for a while like we didn't get hurt economically. They just pushed the problem further. They thought like they can just print it over. And that resulted in very high inflation. First, they devalued the currency by 3 zeros. And then a few years later, they devalued the currency by 1 zero. That was their response, how to defeat the inflation. So the currency lost 4 zeros. 4 zeros the currency lost to, and that blocked inflation in the end. That in combination with very high interest rates, you could have get something like 20%. You can get like 20% if you putted your shekels, you know, the national currency, in the bank. And that also resulted in banks going bankrupt and the government taking them over. And but they managed to stop the inflation. So that is very similar to a lot of times when government has this like a war situation, sometimes a real war or sometimes a fake war like we had this year, and then they pay for it by printing money, and that result in out of control inflation. And imagine today if the dollar lost 3 or 4 zeros of its value. That's a hyperinflationary situation. Let's see what else Michael says. So he says, before Germany hyperinflation in the 1920s, everyone from the elevator operator up was playing the market. And volumes became such that the financial industry could not keep up with the paperwork. And the bourse was obliged to close. Sound familiar, he says? Robin Hood down, he tweeted. Robin Hoods were down a couple of times this year because the volume of trading was too high. And also sometimes they halted trading when there was too much trading on, you know, for example, on GME. So this all sounds what happened, you know, in the last year, very familiar again to what happened in the 1920s. Today, everyone is into stocks. You know, young kids that are maybe not even 18 year olds are opening brokerages account, you know, and putting their only $1,000 or $2,000 to play around with stocks. And, you know, everyone today is into stocks. I'm on purpose. I'm surfing groups, you know, mainstream group investment groups. And let me tell you, people are super bullish, and they are super bullish on the growth names. They are super bullish on the Teslas. And, you know, if you only stay in our community, the people that are into hard money, gold, silver, you know, investment that makes sense from day one, profitable, you know, value stocks, let's say it like that, you will think that you will be in a small bubble. You will think, wow, where everyone thinks like me. But it's not true. If you go especially to people that think, to groups where people think different than you, you will see that we are a very small minority. And the proof for that is that gold investment consists not even in half a percent of investments in the United States. Not even half percent. I'm going to quote Karl Helfreich. He was a financier, a politician, and one of the leading German economists during the 1920s. Quote, "The increase of the circulation has not preceded the rise of prices and the depreciation of the exchange, but it followed slowly and at great distance. The circulation increased from May 1921 to the end of January 1923 by 23 times. It is not possible that this increase had caused the rise in prices of imported goods and of the dollar, which in that period increased by 344 times." Now, as you see, we don't need hyperinflation in the amount of currency units that we have to cause hyperinflation in prices. The German mark only increased by the amount of German marks in circulation by 23 times, but that resulted in 344 times increase in prices and in the exchange compared to dollar, which the dollar at the time was backed by gold. So the dollar was a fixed price to gold. When hyperinflation hits, it's not a mathematical problem anymore. It becomes a psychological problem, a psychological effect. People understand what the government is doing. People understand that if money increased by 23 times, it's going to increase more in the future because the government is abusing and stealing purchasing power from them. And when people understand it, when the masses understand it, they run towards the exit. They buy everything they can buy because buying something now is worth, you know, saving money. You know the money is going to be worth less in the future. So you are going to spend your money as fast as possible and you are going to try to run to the exit and buy as much gold and silver as you can. But at that time, it's impossible to get any gold or silver or anything that is, you know, good against inflation. Investing in gold and silver, or let's say in gold and silver equities, is not going to be an easy trade because we are basically betting against the fiat currency system. By definition, this has to be a very hard trade. Now, I tend to separate buying physical gold and silver and investing in stocks. I don't care what happens with my physical gold. I don't want to sell any of it ever unless I have to. So I don't care for, you know, short term or medium term up and downs. On the other hand, on my investment, I do care. I don't want to be down, you know, 60% or entering the wrong timing or selling the wrong time. And if we just look on the value of the German marks, how much gold was valued in German marks, we can see that until the last collapse in 1923, we have had a few periods where gold dropped. The biggest drop, you can see, happened in early 1920. This was probably like a 50% drop according to the graphs that I can find. That was followed by a long period, almost a year, of stable gold prices before the German mark started to lose value rapidly. And then, in a very short amount of time, it was basically worthless. Now, it is true. Like Barry said, government may try to squash gold, but gold will eventually emerge victorious. We know that because we know history. We know governments, they can try to change reality, but they can't. And what are they going to do? Are they, all the governments in the world are going to ban gold? No, there is no way that's going to happen. And we can see that other governments like Russia, like China, like Iran, they are using that, you know, the West is manipulating the price of gold to accumulate it. So there is players that are going to buy the gold, and whenever we crash the price, they are just going to use these opportunities to buy. They are stealing the wealth from the West. Now, how can governments even manipulate the price of gold when they have two ways? One, of course, is the paper market, where the bullion banks have huge short positions. They have sold paper gold and paper silver that doesn't exist. they will get eventually hurt by this. The other way is when they really just dump physical gold on the market. For example, in the early 2000s, when the Bank of England dumped half of England gold on the market, it was like 300 tons or maybe even more than that, some very big amount. But, you know, at some point, central banks are going to say, no, we have lost control. And our only option is to devalue our currencies in terms of gold. So we need our gold. We can't dump it on the market because we can see that this can't last any longer. And I think we are reaching that point. I think we are reaching the point where it makes more sense for the central banks to devalue their currencies against gold, or that it will become from a crisis that we will reach, you know, very, very high, very sharp inflation that will just devalue the currencies against gold before they can react and sell into the market. Now, like Barry said, in a very high inflation situation, you prefer a dollar today than a dollar tomorrow or in 10 years. So the worst place to be is growth stocks, because in growth stocks, they are not profitable today. They're going to be profitable maybe in 5, 10, 20 years. You know, companies, for example, like Tesla are massive growth stocks. They are supposed to be profitable in the future. In Tesla situation, they are supposed to be like 50% of the market share, if that's what their price is telling us, at least. So every second car on the road is supposed to become a Tesla. One very good place to be, for example, is smoking, you know, tobacco, cigarettes. We know that during recessions and also depressions, people don't smoke less, because there is certain things that people can cut down on when they have less money. For example, they will not go on a vacation. They will, you know, leisure is going down. People don't have money to waste on leisure. But people that smoke can give up on smoking. And also we know that smoking give you a small, relaxation from everything that is going on. So people actually smoke more during recession in the economy or even depressions. And smoking company, tobacco companies are very profitable. They're actually quite cheap today. They went down quite a lot last year. Now I think we had some kind of a rebound, but they're still relatively cheap. They pay a good dividend. And I believe that there will be a good protection against inflation into the future. And it's not something that the government is going to fight against. The government is not going to say the price of cigarettes is too high, you have to sell cigarettes for a cheaper price. It's not going to happen. So it's an inflation protection that is not gonna, you know, fight with the government. The government is not gonna say try to control cigarette companies. And we know that it has a track record of doing really well. Also, cigarettes, they have a lot of the characteristics of money. Cigarettes are actually used in the jail as money. Now, guys, I would really love to know which value stocks or which inflation hedges do you invest in, other than, you know, gold and silver miners or gold and silver. Please write me down in the comment, what do you do? Also, like and subscribe to the channel if you like this video and if you want to see more content like this. Other hedges that I think will do really well other than cigarettes and, you know, precious metals is oil. Oil and also any other energy source that is cheap and good for mass production. If we are going to go into a long period in the economy where we have very high inflation and we have a recession, very long recession or a depression, we are not going to be able to afford all of this, you know, nonsense green energy, you know, wind turbines, solar panels, which are not even good for the environment, you know. And for example, solar panels, after their lifespan of 20, 25 years, you have to throw them somewhere. They are full of heavy metals. What they do is they put them on ships, send them to Africa, destroy the land in Africa. All of these animals that live there and the poor people, the water supply is getting full with heavy metals when the rain drops on these panels. So this is not a good way to protect the environment anyway, but it's also not a cheap source of energy. And I don't think we will be able to afford these expensive and green sources of energy in the future. So I'm actually for oil, for gas, for coal, and also I'm for uranium. So I hope, but I also believe that when we get into the situation where we are in a recession, we will have to go back to the old cheap ways to produce energy, especially in the, you know, countries outside of the West world, outside of Europe, outside of North America. These countries don't really care for all of this green energy. They will just want to produce cheap energy for their people, especially if we are going to be in a worldwide recession. They're not going to go for nonsense like this green energy, renewable energy sources. So I think coal, oil, you know, uranium is a great place to be. And also into that, and government may try to, maybe put a cap on the price if they see the price of oil is going too much. But the only thing that will create is shortages. It doesn't matter, because if you invest in a good oil company, don't invest in some small, explorers. If you invest in a good company with strong balance sheet, you own a portion of their oil in the ground. So if the price is manipulated, they will just not sell oil. They have all the oil in the ground, and that's their asset, and you own a part of that asset. The last inflation hedge I like is agriculture. Agriculture in general is really cheap today. And during inflation, bigger percentage of people's salary goes into agriculture. Financial assets come down in price. These farmers become richer compared to the people that live in the city, because they control the food production, and food is something that no one can give up. You can't give up on food. So I like farming. I like agriculture-related stocks. So I think that will be a really good hedge against inflation. So if you combine all of these things, if you combine energy, you combine precious metals, you combine, commodities that are not gold and silver, maybe some copper, things that are needed, and you combine things that utilities, for example, like the cigarettes, people don't give up on that, I think you have a really, really good inflation hedge against inflationary periods or even hyperinflation.